Okay, so my talk today is about Africa and computer science. Not really two things that you think might go together. But I'm very excited about both things. Let's start with Africa. One interesting thing about Africa is how big it is. I had no idea until I moved there. The way the map projections work, it's not clear that it's so big. It is so diverse. When you talk about Africa, it doesn't really make sense. You know, and it's like saying that, you know, China is the same as the United States. That's not the case. It's a very diverse, very interesting place to live and work. And I find it fantastically stimulating, and I love living there. The other thing that I find fantastically stimulating is computer technology. I know this may seem a little bizarre, but I do find it exciting. And one of the reasons I find it exciting is because of this, Moore's Law, which you may have come across before. It's from Gordon Moore, one of the founders of Intel. And he said that every 2 years, well, 18 months to 2 years, the amount of circuitry you can get on a piece of silicon doubles. I can tell you're stunned, right? I find that fantastically exciting, and I'm going to explain to you why. When I first read that, I thought, well, doubles, what does that mean? Well, let's look at it this way. In 1996, I bought my first cell phone. Here it is. It has many advanced features, like an aerial. I had to leave the battery at home. I don't know if you can see that. Because it would have put me over my luggage allowance on the flight. It's about this long. It lasts 8 hours. Now, that was 1996. How many of you were born in 1996? What were you about? Okay, not many of you. Okay, so I feel old. So, here's my phone in 1996. Let's say that rectangle represents how much the internal electronics of my cell phone cost. Right? Now, 2 years later, Moore's Law, we see that the cost of those components, an entry-level Nokia 5110 in 1998, to make those internal electronic components cost half that much. We go down to 2000, 2002, hello, 2004, 2006, 2008. There's where we are today, 2010. Moore's Law means that the cost of the electronics in the phone is this much. Right? In 14 years. Now that to me is astonishing. Right? Technology has become so much cheaper. You think doubling, it's a geometric growth, which it's hard to get your head around. Now, one consequence of Moore's Law is what we saw in Abby's talk, the one before mine, about ubiquitous computing. Right? We saw the SenseCam here. But we also see computers in our vacuum cleaners, in our tables, strapped to our heads, in our coffee cups. Ubiquitous computing means that computers now get everywhere around us. And I don't know if that excites you, or scares you, or depresses you, but one other consequence of Moore's Law, besides ubiquitous computing, that is not talked about so much, is global computing. Here's another map of Africa. This time, what you're seeing is the GSM coverage, the cell phone network throughout Africa. The bits that are purple or blue are 3G networks, and the rest are 2G standard networks. Okay. So something like 10 countries in Africa have 90% coverage of cell phones. So that, what that means throughout 90% of the population, if they held up a cell phone, they would get a signal. Are you surprised by that? If you're in the Sahara, frankly, you're stuffed. But anywhere else, you're in pretty good shape. There's not a lot in Namibia. There are only 2 million people there, so you don't need a lot of coverage. Eight or more countries in Africa have 70%. Zimbabwe, which hasn't had a functioning government, really, in about 10, 15 years, has got 70% coverage of cell phone network. Mobile phones are everywhere within Africa. And this is the one that really interests me. It has now become the most important market for Nokia globally. This is where Nokia sell most of their handsets. It's something like 50% growth year on year. So that's why technology is important in Africa. It is becoming ubiquitous. So computers are becoming ubiquitous in the sense that there are a lot around us, but becoming ubiquitous in the sense that there are a lot around the planet. So I'm a computer scientist. What does a computer scientist do with this? What is computer science? Again, it doesn't seem maybe to have much relevance to Africa, but if you remember Simon's talk, he ended it off by saying that part of what computer science is about is abstraction. Solving a problem. And computer scientists are very good at abstraction. What I mean by this is we are good at building layers. So we filter out all the unnecessary detail and give people tools that let them do their jobs. So for example, if you had an Intel 2, if I give you an Intel 2 processor or a Core 2, it would just be a lump of silicon with some wires. Not incredibly useful. So we wrap a layer around that. We build a stack and we make something like Windows, an operating system that lets you use that processor. Well, not everyone wants to use an operating system, so computer scientists design programming languages that let you write programs to solve problems. And if you don't want to write your own software, then you can buy some. So you can buy Microsoft Office that's written in C#, that runs on Windows, that runs on an Intel processor. It's all these layers of abstraction. This is what computer scientists do a lot of the time. Now, Office is a fantastic product if you're working in an office, if you're writing documents, if you're creating PowerPoints, if you're doing spreadsheets, brilliant. But is that what people in Africa want to do? Are there many, many office workers sitting in Africa ready to type? So if only someone would send us Office, it would be great. That's not the case. There are different issues, there are different problems. Remember, Africa is this big place, all sorts of diverse problems. So as a computer scientist, what should we be doing in Africa? And so on my last sabbatical, I spent a lot of time going around Africa, visiting different countries and looking at problems. And I became inspired. I came across a guy who owned a Unix bicycle, an operating system bicycle, right? Now, he had upgraded, he had installed layers of abstraction on top of his bicycle. First thing he did was he built this out of reinforced steel. Now, what that is an egg carrier. It will hold up to 70 kilos of eggs, which he ties down with this rubber strip, so he can deliver eggs. He also upgraded his suspension. Look, on the seat here, he put in bits of soft wood. He pimped his ride. And now, and it's not just this guy, right? You see, so what you have is these guys run a taxi business. And you can sit on the back, and so if you imagine the guy is here cycling, right? Behind him is the paying passenger. And then behind them again are the 70 kilos of eggs. Now, as the passenger, you got to hope he ain't going to fall. You don't want 70 kilos of eggs on top of you. But this inspired me. What it showed me is if you give people the correct tools, they will be able to design solutions for themselves and create solutions like this guy has done with his bicycle. And it's interesting that the bicycle is named after an operating system because it is the core technology underlying many of the solutions in Africa. You can get water pumps, generators, and so on, all built around the bicycle. So if you want to build the digital equivalent of that, what might it look like? Ah, we're missing a slide here, but not to worry. So part of my work, that after that sabbatical, I actually came to Cambridge to work with Microsoft Research. And I was talking to the guys here, and I said, lots of people in Africa have cell phones, mobile phones, but no one can afford airtime. Everyone in Africa is waiting for someone else to phone them. Now, clearly, that's not sustainable. Someone's going to make their call. And I met another guy who had a cell phone that was an MP3 player, but he had 3 MP3s on it. And I said to him, where do you get new songs from? And he says, I don't. I can't afford the airtime to download new songs. Right? Remember, this guy, he's only got a cell phone. There's no PC, there's no internet, there's no nothing. So he had been listening to 3 songs for the last 6 months. Imagine that. Right? Imagine I said to each one of you, okay, you can pick 3 songs to listen to for the rest of your life. You're going to get bored of them. So what we did was build a system called Big Board, Snap and Grab, that works as follows. What you're seeing here is a computer screen. It's a big 40-inch display, and someone comes along with a normal handset, right? This is not any special handset. There's no special software on it. They see something on the screen they want, so they take a picture of it. Now, this is one of my students who loves Beyoncé, so he took a picture of Beyoncé. At that point, you share via Bluetooth, right? So you take that photograph and you Bluetooth it to the computer running the screen. Is everyone with me so far? Okay, so the screen, here's the screen, Snap and Grab board. The screen does image recognition on it. So here we go, it gets sent. So you can see here it's processing the photograph, it's recognized it as Beyoncé. And at that point, the computer running the screen Bluetooths back videos, music, anything you care to think of. Make sense? Just out of interest, how many of you have Bluetoothed or shared stuff with friends, like videos? Okay, almost everyone in this room, right? So this will be familiar to you. Why do you do it? Why don't you upload? Because it costs nothing, right? Exactly. It's free. It's straightforward. It's easy to do. So this is my Andrew receiving a video of Beyoncé. Now, Beyoncé is slightly trivial, but we've used this in terms of voter education, right? If you're going to vote for someone and you can't read what they've written, how do you know what they're going to do, right? So we installed some of these at voter registration systems. People come along, go, I might vote for that guy, take a picture of him, and they get an MP3 of the guy reading out what his policy would be. And so you can listen to it. You don't need to be able to read. And we left it in one of the townships in Cape Town, and people used it for all sorts of things. People advertised jobs. So let's say I'm a plumber, your pipes broke, you come along, take a picture of me, you get all my details, you phone me, I come and fix your pipes. Yeah? They used the, there are 2 ways. So if you can't, when, it's not a binary thing. You can't read and you can read. People have very small levels of literacy. And so they, within a community, what we find is as soon as someone figures it out, they teach people the steps, the buttons they need to press in order to make it happen. So there's we've written lots of research, and people in India find the same thing. So they kind of memorize the steps. But you're right, it is a big problem. So there are all sorts of applications for Big Board. And that was a platform that we built. Again, remember, it's about abstraction. It's about building a tool that lots of people can use. A colleague of mine called Ulrika has been working on a Gates Foundation project. A big problem in South Africa is water quality. And she worked with a team at the University of Bristol, and they invented this little pot, I guess. And what you do with the pot is you fill it up with water from your local water supply. This is the base of the pot. You can see that it's divided up into different segments. Each segment contains a different chemical, and so when you pour the water in, the different chemicals react and turn different colors depending on what is in the water. Now, when they designed this, Ulrika said, hang on, that looks a bit like the shot codes. You know the 2D barcodes that you get on posters for cell phone recognition? Have you seen these? Yeah? And so she said, well, what we can do is we can write a little application for the cell phone so that you hold up the pot, you take a picture of it, it reads the shot code and goes, oh my goodness, don't drink the water. And again, back to your point about literacy, what it does is actually shows on the screen a little picture of the water being boiled or people adding chlorine to the water or depending to show what they should do to make the water safe to drink. And this platform, it's been used for water, it's been used for remote data capture, for all sorts of things. wherever the government need to know quality on water, air pollution, and so on. They can empower someone locally, they can put software on their cell phone, and remotely this data can be taken and collected. So again, it's another platform. Another problem that perhaps you don't have in Cambridge is lack of internet infrastructure, lack of cell phone infrastructure. There are many places in Africa that don't have access. And so we build devices like these. This is called a mesh potato. If you're a computer scientist, this is what passes as humor. So go with it, right? Mesh stands for mesh networking. In other words, these little things, there's no configuration. I don't know if you've ever tried to configure a router or anything at home. You just start turning these things on. They find their nearest neighbor, and they connect. And in fact, the algorithm works a bit like Dijkstra's algorithm that you saw earlier about how it routes the traffic through the network. If one of the network nodes gets taken out, the network automatically self-heals. So again, we're building this platform to let people communicate. These things, once you buy them and you connect them to each other, they cost nothing to send messages across. And then finally, the last system I'm going to talk about is one built by one of my colleagues at Cape Town called the Cyber Tracker System. This system was built because these are the Khoisan people. Have you seen that movie, The Gods Must Be Crazy? Okay, a few of you have. And so you'll know that these guys are fantastic trackers. I mean, if you spend any time with these guys, you're walking through the Kruger Park or whatever, and they go, ooh, and they will point at a broken blade of grass. And they'll go, four elephants passed here, one of them was a baby, and it was sick. And you're like, no. And you walk a bit further, and you go around the corner, and there are four elephants, one of them's a baby, going, flip. So these people are highly literate in grass and soil, but not in written forms of communication. And the problem was that they worked in the national parks in South Africa, but when they saw this, they couldn't write down and send into the ranger that four elephants passed here and one of them was sick. There was no way for them to communicate. But so the guys on this team realized that because the culture is highly visual, highly iconic, they could build a system where they could just tap images and record. So they could record a clip springer who was drinking or eating or doing other things. I'll leave to your imagination to decide what those are. And suddenly, again, this is a project about remote data capture. All these guys who were kind of cut out of technology, right? That if you can't read, you can't write, you can't use technology. Not true. It's just that we have different problems in Africa. And so by building this system based on highly iconic interfaces, the text there actually is to help the guys learn the language. The language here is Afrikaans. And it splits up into syllables very nicely. So the words are there to help reinforce and help the guys learn some language as they go, written language. So we built all these different platforms. And so just to come back to the start, I think computer science and Moore's Law have meant that not only is technology really exciting in the developed world, but it's also really exciting in the developing world. Technology is coming there for the first time. Really, in the past 5 years, the growth in access to cellular handsets is absolutely phenomenal. Most people on the planet, their exposure to technology will be through mobile telephone handsets. You know, fortunately, a bit more advanced than this. So on the internet at the moment, there are possibly about 2 billion PCs. On the GSM network at the moment, there are 5 billion devices. Even in South Africa, there are more devices connected to the GSM network than there are people. That is, it's very hard to fathom and try and understand what that actually means. So most people's experience of computing technology will now be the mobile handset. How does that affect computer science? What should we be teaching mobile development instead of PC development? I don't know. Maybe we should. And so as a computer scientist, there's someone who's educating in Africa. we've got to start all over again, but in a good way, right? We've got to understand what the new problems are, what the layers of abstraction, what are the platforms we need to build to let other people build their technology on top. And that is what we're about. And some of the projects, the projects that you're going to see here today are the advanced end, but also I've got a big board in the demo room if you want to come and see that at lunchtime and get a feel for how it could be used with blue technology.